IVM.
Hey everybody, welcome to another amazing week on the IVM Podcast Network. If you aren't following us on social media, please do. We're IVM Podcast on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. We'd like to thank our sponsors this week, Paytm Money, for supporting the network. Guys, you should definitely check out some of the content that we're doing recently, which is somewhat COVID-related. Pavan's been doing an awesome job on the Pragati Podcast. All Think Policy has also got a tremendous number of really, really great episodes about what's going on and the impact. We talk about this stuff on Cyrus Says, especially in the Cock and Bull episode. On Advertising is Dead, Varun's had a couple of episodes where he's spoken about the impact of this, as is Karthik on the Filter Coffee Podcast. And I mean, like, you know, across the network, definitely do check it out. I'm sure you'll enjoy yourself. And with that, let's get you to your show.
Welcome to All Things Policy, a daily podcast by the Takshashila Institution. We are a bunch of policy nerds based in Bengaluru, and we like bringing fresh perspectives to Indian affairs and Indian perspectives to global affairs. So grab a cup of coffee, sit back, and join us for today's chat.
Hello and welcome to All Things Policy. How long will it be before any of us gets to roll up a sleeve and get injected with a vaccine for this novel coronavirus that has kept all of us at home? What is it going to take to get to a successful vaccine? And why do so many people worry that we may never have a vaccine? To discuss this whole torturous path through a vaccine and the challenges and risks involved, and what India can do, I'm joined by Shambhavi and Sunila. Welcome, guys. Now, obviously, we're all desperately waiting for that vaccine so that we can get back to something resembling normalcy in our lives. But this isn't something that's going to happen very soon, obviously. I want to start with a very basic question. Sunila, can you tell us, how does a vaccine work?
Yes. So vaccines work by introducing enough identifying information about a bacteria or virus which causes the body to produce an immune response without actually causing the illness. Basically, we are introducing the bacteria which causes the disease in the body, but in a very minimum amount and in a very tamed down version of the bacteria or the virus. So when this tamed down version of the virus is introduced in our body, it produces antibodies which attach to the substances called antigens on the surface of the virus, which then sends a signal to our body to attack. So this is how immune response is developed by our body to the vaccine.
Okay, you're describing what we call live or attenuated viruses. There are also these new things called mRNA viruses. How are they different?
Basically, there are two types of vaccines, live attenuated, where the whole virus that has been weakened is introduced in the body. And the second type is inactivated, where the virus has been killed and it is introduced in the body, or small parts of virus such as proteins or sugars. But there's this recently introduced type of vaccine called the RNA and DNA vaccine. So rather than injecting a pathogen's antigen into our body, you give the body the genetic code needed to produce that antigen itself. So as RNA vaccines let your body do most of the work, they don't require much material. So these vaccines are basically telling our body to produce the antigen, which in turn will produce the antibodies.
Now, vaccines have been around for a long time. I'm sure we have a lot of experience with them. Now you have these RNA, DNA vaccines. Why is developing a vaccine so difficult? Why aren't we much further into the process already?
A lot of these new technologies, the DNA vaccine, for example, are currently unlicensed. So we don't actually have, for any disease, a DNA vaccine that we know will completely and successfully work. Now, the way a vaccine works is what you're typically... So, if you think of the antibody-antigen reaction that Sunita spoke about, like a lock and key, right? So, you have your body generates an antibody response after recognizing a particular protein or a sugar on the incoming virus. So that's the lock that it has to then recognize. So there are multiple factors on which this recognition actually is determined, a lot of viruses mutate, right? So when it comes to creating a vaccine, you basically think about the antigen-antibody reaction that Sunila was talking about, like a lock and key, right? So the antibodies that your body generate has to recognize this antigen on the surface of the virus. Now, the virus can change, and some viruses change faster than other viruses. And if they change, then it's very difficult to generate antibody response for that particular strain of the virus that has changed. So if you think about it, for the flu virus, for example, you have to take a vaccine every year for the strain that's prevalent then, because basically those proteins change. If you think about the HIV virus, the HIV mutates so frequently that we just have not been able to create a vaccine to stay with that kind of mutation rate. And we have known HIV for a very long time. Now, the good thing about the coronavirus is that the coronavirus does not seem to mutate as frequently as some of the other viruses. And so there's hope that we will find a vaccine for it. But on the other hand, we have four other coronaviruses which have been circulating in humans. I don't think we have ever tried to create a vaccine for it because they cause common colds. So it is nothing as severe as our current COVID-19. So obviously a worldwide coordinated effort of the scale we are currently seeing has not been made so far. So that's it. So we really need to know the virus very well. And the virus has to have a certain amount of stability in its mutation rate for us to actually create a vaccine. Then once we actually create that kind of vaccine, so once we understand how good the virus is, create a replica that will actually cause the immune reaction. The second stage is for that replica to actually form the immune reaction. So for example, if you see with the dengue vaccine, we have a pretty good vaccine that was being trialed, Dengvaxia from Sanofi. But what we saw later on was that people who received the vaccine and had not been previously infected showed really severe form of the disease afterwards. So this came up in clinical trials. So these are some of the other problems that we see with vaccines. So safety, efficacy are two big things that we have to work with.
So then it would seem that it is more feasible to have a vaccine for the novel coronavirus than, say, maybe HIV. What is our situation now? We hear of something like 90, perhaps 100 vaccine candidates. How many of these are going to be successful? What is the process from here on?
Right. So we have quite a bunch of candidates across the world. There are a lot of collaborations which are currently happening. The WHO has launched its own platforms for collaboration across both vaccine designers as well as manufacturers to not only get the vaccine made as in designed quickly, but actually manufactured in the huge amounts that we are going to need it as well. We have more than 80, I think, which are in preclinical trials, and about 7 which are currently in clinical trials, so in human trials, are ongoing. And these again come, there are some which are DNA or an mRNA based vaccine, some which are inactivated vaccines. Our most optimistic scenario is that we will have a vaccine, that could be given to people by mid of next year. I think President Trump came on today to say that we'll have it by the end of the year, but that's going to be a slightly more optimistic scenario. Our worst case scenario obviously is going to be like HIV, where we have no vaccine, because we're still also learning a lot about this virus. It's completely novel to our systems as well. I think the vaccine that we hear most about is the one made by the Jenner Institute at the Oxford University. Serum Institute in India has already started manufacturing that vaccine, even though it is still pending clinical trials and approval. The idea being that once it gets approved, we already have some stock available and we can give it to people ASAP. Oxford University has also tied up with AstraZeneca to create, I think, 100 million doses or so by the end of this year. So that's a recombinant viral vector vaccine. So what that basically does is it has taken a virus which is known as the adenovirus. It's a pretty harmless virus that is usually floating around humans and chimpanzees. And then they have put in some of the spike proteins, the corona proteins that you see that form the crown around the virus. So some of them into that harmless virus so that once it goes into the body, it creates the spike protein and you'll have an antibody response. So the way clinical trials will now proceed is that they have given the vaccine to healthy volunteers, and they will assess those volunteers for their health responses, vital signs, and the kind of antibodies that are being generated by their body over the next few months. And then they will slowly increase the size of that trial. So that is going to take a few months at least. It is showing optimistic results. There are no safety concerns as of yet. So a couple of the volunteers are actually on Twitter and they come online to say that they're doing well. So it seems optimistic currently. So we have quite a few of these which are in the pipeline. So hopefully by the end of the year, we should have one that at least we can say will kind of work.
I think there's been no real concern that this particular vaccine is not safe. I think the open question today is whether it's going to be effective. But I want to ask you, Sunila, what are the stages of vaccine development? Why are they so important? What is this phase one, phase two, phase three? And what is this idea of giving the vaccine early to, say, healthcare people and, you know, people most at risk?
Right. In the first phase, the vaccine is tested on animals to see if it is working. Now, many sections do not agree with testing on animals, but it is something that they have to go through. In the next phase, a small study is conducted in healthy people, as Shambhavi said before, that evaluates the vaccine for safety and immune response at different doses. Now, for COVID-19 trials, this is expected to take 3 months, but typically it takes 1 to 2 years. In the second phase, a randomized controlled study of hundreds of people is conducted to further evaluate the safety and assess the efficacy of the vaccine. This stage typically takes 2 to 3 years, but for COVID-19 trials, they are planning to get it done within 8 months or so. In the next phase, it is similar to the phase I mentioned before, but it is conducted with thousands of subjects. And this can take about 2 to 4 years if combined with the previous phase. After this phase, there is a regulatory review where the governmental body reviews the trial data and other information in the licensing application. This typically takes 1 to 2 years, but is likely to be expedited to take only a few months. And after the vaccine is approved, it is manufactured and then it is supplied to the distributors, and then it is given to the people in need. And once the vaccine is given to the people, post-approval studies that monitor effectiveness in real-world conditions are conducted. So this is how it goes for the development of vaccine.
So obviously we understand that there is this need to speed up the process for this vaccination. But Shambhavi, what are the risks involved in speeding up these processes that typically take several years?
Yeah, so there are a lot of variables that go into creating a successful vaccine, right? And those, obviously, even if you trial them very exhaustively in non-human primates and other animals, a little difficult to judge what will happen inside the human body. I think a classic example, again, of this is the dengue vaccine, the Dengvaxia. So when it first came a couple of years ago, Sanofi asked a lot of countries to waive off the phase 3 trials. And to simply start marketing and commercializing it because these countries obviously have a huge burden of dengue disease. India had refused to do that, but other countries went ahead and did give the vaccine. I think Philippines and Thailand and a few other countries. And soon they found that the kids who were receiving the vaccine but had not suffered from dengue before were developing extremely severe form of dengue, and there were a few deaths which eventually got linked to the vaccine, and the vaccine was stopped. And so Sanofi is now working on a better version, but I think there's a kind of data you lose out if you do not have exhaustive clinical trials. So that is what we are looking at. Expediting can obviously bring those kind of risks to the fore.
All right. Now, we obviously have a lot of vaccine candidates, and there are a few from India. What is India doing? What are the collaborations India is undertaking? Is it also developing vaccines by itself?
Yeah, so we are developing indigenous vaccines. So a lot of the Indian governmental agencies, DBT included, have proposed funding for vaccines. So we have Zydus Cadila, which is working on two vaccines, Biological E, Indian Immunologicals, Minvax, which are all developing vaccines. IIT Guwahati is collaborating with Hester Biosciences Limited, which is an Ahmedabad-based pharmaceutical company, to work on a COVID-19 vaccine. So there are some candidates which are being developed inside the country. But also, obviously, India is the biggest manufacturer of vaccines. So a lot of the countries outside who are actually creating vaccines, designing them, are looking towards India as a big manufacturing hub. Serum Institute in Pune has already started manufacturing the vaccine being developed at Oxford. They also have signed up with a company in Seattle to start building up their vaccines as well. Bharat Biotech in Hyderabad has announced a partnership with the University of Wisconsin-Madison and US-based firm Flugen to make almost, I think, 300 million doses of the vaccine for global distribution. So once those get approved, so there's quite a bit of activity which is happening on the Indian scene. And generally, if you look around the world, Aditya, about 72% of all of these vaccine candidates are basically based out of private companies or industries, whereas about 28% are public sector or not for profit. While they get designed there, India should be a big manufacturing hub for creating the large repository of vaccine doses that we will need. I mean, the expectation is that you will need at least 70% of the world's population to be vaccinated for it to have any sort of impact on providing herd immunity against the coronavirus. So we are going to need billions and billions of doses.
Yeah, and I'm sure that there's differences in how easy it is to manufacture each vaccine, right? I'm sure that some of the more complicated vaccines are maybe hard to scale, and certainly any vaccine would be more complicated to make than, say, making a strip of paracetamol.
Yeah, I mean, there are a lot of accreditations that you need to achieve in order to create a vaccine that has to go inside a person. All steps have to be carefully managed. There's technology transfer that needs to happen. But a lot of the Indian companies are set up to do this. I mean, we do provide a majority of the world's vaccines. So we have all the processes in place. It is just now waiting for that candidate to be approved.
Okay. Well, you know, you talked earlier in this episode about HIV and how it's been, 3.5 decades, and we still haven't got a vaccine for it, and we don't know if one will ever be made. What if there is no vaccine for COVID-19?
There is, that scenario can always exist, that we do not get a vaccine. As long as it doesn't mutate a lot and we already have a lot of people who are get exposed to the virus in this segment, there'll be some sort of immunity that is built up, at least in those people. We still don't know whether people who have got the vaccine this time are completely immune to getting a second round. There have been a few cases where people have got the virus again. The problem, obviously, with the idea that we can build herd immunity this way is that the fatality rate of COVID-19 is pretty high. So the UK obviously went for this kind of approach where they said that we are going to let the people who are less susceptible to the severe form of COVID-19 get the disease so that we build a sort of herd immunity, and that did not work. That did probably also not work in an Indian context, primarily I think because we have a lot of these 60 plus year olds continue to live with their children and their grandchildren, and so will be exposed to the virus even if their children could continue to go out and they stay at home, right? So in that case, extreme social distancing remains our best hope till we figure out a way of till we actually learn more about the virus. I don't think we have had the time to sit back and think a lot about the way the virus attacks, say, the cells in the lung. We don't know why there are so many asymptomatic carriers as opposed to some people who develop a very severe form of the disease. So as we learn more about it, hopefully we will have a better handle on what can we do to prevent its spread and also maybe develop drugs against it.
Right. So if we don't have a vaccine, the options would be something like along the lines of HIV, you'll have maybe some effective antivirals, some prophylactics, yes, something along those lines.
Yes. The other thing, obviously, Aditya, is we have seen some sort of this cross-vaccination benefit be and is yet to be proven. But for example, the BCG and the polio vaccine OPV, countries which have received them, which continue to have a BCG program, for example, seem to be on the lower spectrum of burden. But we still don't know whether, I mean, there are so many other factors that go into it, and we'll have to look at it at the individual level and do a scientific study of it. But there's a possibility that at least some other vaccines might give some sort of prevention or mitigation against COVID-19, but we need to study that further.
Right. So there are a bunch of BCG trials that are starting in various countries in EU and Australia. I think India is also planning that. And hopefully there'll be some similar trials with the OPV polio vaccine. And these might, you know, provide some sort of bridge before we get to hopefully an effective vaccine for this specific illness. But, you know, we're talking so much about vaccines. We're talking about, you know, maybe we'll take a fresh BCG vaccine. And then after that, we'll get a COVID-19 vaccine. And we need to repeatedly take this COVID-19 vaccine. Why does all this leave the anti-vaxxer movement? Because it's not an insignificant thing anymore. And it's not just that in the developed world. There is a resistance to getting vaccinations all over the world. What happens to that?
Right. And we have seen actually the anti-vaxxer movement have a resurgence over the past few years. So this has actually brought a lot of questions to the fore. I mean, if you are battling for a world without no vaccines, you can see what the effect of not having this one vaccine is having currently, right? People are in lockdown everywhere, waiting for this one vaccine to come up. So clearly the anti-vaxxers have been, there were a lot of questions been raised about the anti-vaxxers movement. The anti-vaxxers themselves, I think, believe that this is a big conspiracy against them. They believe that this is Bill Gates and all of the world's big corporations coming together and creating this sort of atmosphere where there seems to be this total dependency on a vaccine to kind of further their agenda and fill the pockets of Big Pharma. Obviously, I think from a Big Pharma point of view, it makes no sense. I think anyone who makes vaccines and drugs would realize that making a drug is always more profitable than making a vaccine. Simply because you can give it to more people and you can give it repeatedly. Whereas a vaccine usually, in most cases, works only once. Sometimes you need booster doses, but still it prevents a lot of the other add-on stuff that a pharma company can make money out of. So I don't believe that there's a conspiracy there at all. But the anti-vaccination movement is facing a little bit of heat right now because obviously, I mean, we need the vaccine. It's going to be very, very difficult without it.
Right. Yeah, I suppose a lot of these conspiracy theories are comforting to believers at some level because they suggest that there is a plan, there is a big plan being hatched by someone, and that there is a way out of this plan. It's almost scarier to imagine that these are a bunch of chance events, this zoonotic transmission of some random virus from a bat through maybe some other animal to humans, and that we are stuck in this situation now. You know, if anything, this chance event actually keeps reminding us of our own mortality, of how we are such physically frail creatures. In the meantime, let's just hope that...
I also think a lot. So I was watching the movie Contagion. I had never seen it before. And after, obviously, after the pandemic started, a lot of people said, oh, this reminds us a lot of that movie. And so I watched it. And the entire movie is based on this thing that at the end, oh, they come up with a vaccine and that's how everyone gets liberated. I don't think that's the scenario that we are headed towards. That's stuff that we should be doing anyways as we wait for the vaccine to come up. But there is no way that all of this has been generated in a manner that the vaccine has to come for us to be liberated. I mean, no, I don't think anyone made this just to benefit the vaccine creator.
Not at all. And I think the one thing that maybe the movie Contagion took a liberty with was the speed with which the vaccine is developed.
Oh yeah,
it's going to be a much harder slog in real life. Anyway, on that note, thank you so much, Doc and Sunila, and thank you for joining us on All Things Policy.
If you liked our show, don't forget to check out other interesting podcasts on the IVM network. You can tune into them on the IVM Podcast app, ivmpodcast.com, or wherever you listen to your podcasts. You can also follow IVM on social media. The handle is at IVM Podcasts on Twitter, Facebook and Instagram. And hey, if you'd like to dive into Takshashila's research on technology, strategy and economic affairs, check us out at our Twitter handle at TakshashilaInst or our website takshashila.org.in.
Entertainment is like food for the brain. It's a window to culture and a great way to understand the world around us. The internet has changed what it means to be an entertainer, creating new storytellers with millions of fans. It has spawned a new breed, the story sellers, those behind the scenes creating the business for this ecosystem. They work with brands, platforms and channels who are keen to capitalize on an audience hungrier than ever for more stories. I'm Vineet Kanabar, and I have a ringside view to how stories are told and sold. On my show, I bring you creators, artists, executives, and marketers for a freewheeling conversation around the business of entertainment. Tune in to Storytellers and Story Sellers for personal stories, analysis, and criticism every Thursdays as I talk to the brightest minds telling or selling great stories today.
Welcome to Peak Planet, a new podcast where we delve into the fallouts of the growth path that we, and indeed much of the world, has chosen. Sustainable growth is the buzzword. Until we nail that down, we need to ensure that we keep our population healthy and also have the resources for our increasingly urban lifestyles. I'm Karthik Ganesan, a researcher at the Council on Energy, Environment and Water, a Delhi-based policy research institute where for almost a decade we've been trying to explain and change the use, reuse and misuse of our resources. In the first season of Peak Planet, we take up air pollution, public enemy number one, and an invisible one at that. Increasingly, the most important risk factor for adverse health outcomes, air pollution has become the most unwanted byproduct for an aggressively growing economy. Over four episodes, we find out how prepared our systems are to deal with this crisis.
You can catch the entire first season of Peak Planet out now on the IVM Podcasts app or website, or wherever you get your podcasts from.